Chodesh Tov, everybody. We are celebrating today Rosh Chodesh Tammuz. Zad Hashem, Hashem should bless you with a month of health and success, happiness, and goals should be achieved. Now, we have just finished praying Tfilat Shacharit, Baruch Hashem, was a beautiful prayer. And in between the first part of the prayer of Shmona Esre and the reading of the Halel and Kriyat HaTorah, we added a Psalm of Tehillim. And this is customary to most congregation, most Nosachim, that we add the Psalm of Tehillim that is called Barchi Nafshi Et Hashem. Comes a question, why do we pray that? Why do we add that? There was many questions why we do things on Rosh Chodesh, like you asked before, why we don't pray Musaf with Tefillin on our head and many others. But today we're going to just address a little bit why we read that extra Psalm of Tehillim, Barchi Nafshi Et Hashem. And it says there, Sham Ktiv, it says over there, there's one of the verses there, it says, Yitamu Chataim Min Haaretz. The sins should finish. We should not have any more sins in the world. Yitamu, they're going to finish. When is this going to happen? Of course, when Mashiach is going to come, the prophet Yeshaya says, Ve'et Ruach HaTum'ah Avir Min Haaretz. The spirit, the power of impurity is going to be removed from this world. And by default, there's not going to be anything evil. Not going to be anything evil, which means there's not going to be any more sins. Because there's not going to be hate, there's not going to be jealousy, there's not going to be anything. Amen. So, when is this going to really happen? When Mashiach is going to come. When, of course, this is going to happen? When Mashiach is going to come? When we're not going to have any more sins. This would be a kind of a more nicer world. I wouldn't mind having a world without sins anymore. You don't have to worry about jealousy and hate and people talking about you. You talking about people. And like we just mentioned now, all these desires, the forbidden lusts that we have. And who needs this headache? Let me just sit all day long with a nice book, read, get inspired, learn the Torah. Who needs this headache? But nevertheless, it says in this verse of Tehillim, Yitamu Chataim Min Haaretz. Yitamu means that they will finish. Tom, it's finished. The sins from the land. Ve'ainyan, what does it mean? Ki ha-yetzer hara v'asit ra'acha hem chaserim. The Yetzer Hara is one of the generals in the army of the Sit Ra'acha. Sit Ra'acha is a definition of the other side. So the Sit Ra'acha is just the definition. You know how the armies, they have names. So we don't have to start naming the names of the armies, but armies have names, whether it's the IDF or the whatever it is. But the Samech Mem is the devil, he's the Satan. We don't call him by his name. His name is pronounced and written Samech Mem Aleph Lamed. And we don't say his name, because when you say his name, you invite him. So we just call him by his short name, Sami. Samech Mem we call him. And he has a whole army. He has generals and colonels and the commando. And in his army, he has, of course, the Sit Ra'acha, is the other side, that's the whole army. One of them is the Yetzer Hara. Some say he is the Yetzer Hara. Some say he has messengers. But nevertheless, the Sit Ra'acha and the Yetzer Hara, they're lacking something. They have some type of a deficiency. And that's their weakness. But on the other hand, אבל קדושה היא בחינת שלמות. Holiness is whole. That's why it's called holiness. Holy. In Israel, in Hebrew, the words make perfect sense. They have a lot of meaning to it. In English, every now and then, there'll be a spark of some secret behind the word. So you say the word holy because it's whole. It's shalem, something that is full and complete. Now, when you have a full elevator, can somebody walk in? No, it's full. You have a full box, it's full. My cup is full. You can't put anything else in there. So when you reach to a level of perfection, of holiness, and holiness here, it's the word in Hebrew will not, in English, will not make much sense. But in Hebrew, shlemut, shalem is full. There's no more room for anything else, even if you want to. So in the Yetzer Hara, in the Sit Ra'acha, there's lacking something. It's missing something. So obviously there's room for more. But in Kedusha, in holiness, there's no more room. It's full. It's completely full. So nothing else can come in. This is a very, very profound message. So we know that the Kedusha is Bechinat Shlemut. It has holiness. It's whole, full. Ki ein Shlemut ela beKedusha. The only thing that can have 100% of it is Kedusha, holiness. Anything else cannot have 100%. Vayetzer Hara, Vasitra Acha, the other side of holiness, and the Yetzer Hara, Nikreim Chaserim, they're called, they're missing something. In Hebrew, there's one word for it, it's called Chaser. Chaserim, they're missing something. Venikreim Arziyut. And that is called in Hebrew Arziyut. Arziyut comes from the word in Hebrew Eretz. Eretz is the land. Inektiv, it says in the Torah, Ve'ahavta et Hashem Elokecha. We read that twice a day. Technically, we should read it three times a day. It's Kriyat Shema. And we say there, in Kriyat Shema, Ve'ahavta et Hashem Elokecha. You should love your God. What will we add there? Bechol levavcha, with all your heart. How am I going to have love Hashem? With my foot? Like, what does it mean? What's the term here? Why does it say bechol levavcha? I don't know who invented it. It's actually very interesting to somehow track where it came from. But in this world, when you want to express love, you do a heart. And now it's very common that when people send each other text messages, they have all these hearts and sparkles and all this junk. But nevertheless, the heart represents love. I don't know, maybe they're taking it from this verse, Ve'avta et Hashem Elokecha bechol levavcha, or maybe Hallmark or somebody invented that love is connected to hearts. Nevertheless, in the Torah it says that you should have your God with all your heart. What does it mean with all your heart? Now in Hebrew, it doesn't say bechol halev. It says bechol levavcha. So we see here two hearts. Levavcha. Which basically saying with two hearts. What does it mean two hearts? Ask a cardiologist, he'll tell you that the heart has two chambers. There's two parts of the heart. So one part of the heart is where the Yetzer Tov is, the good inclination is, and one part of the heart is where the Yetzer Hara is, the bad inclination is. Beshnei Yetzarecha, when it says Bechol Levavcha, means both sides. Beyetzer HaTov, Beyetzer Hara, good inclination and the bad inclination. Ki mechuyavim likach re'aya gdola, we are obligated to take re'aya, is more like a proof or a testimony. La'avod et Hashem min ha'yetzer hara be'atzmo. We have to look how the, why am I saying testimony? I mean, this is a word that I find it hard to translate, but I'll explain what I mean. You'll figure it out. To take testimony is to see what the Yetzer Hara does and to mimic him. But to my Avodat Hashem. So this is what it means to take testimony, to take proof from what the Yetzer Hara is doing. צריך מחויבים לקחת ראיה גדולה לעבוד השם מן היצר הרע בעצמו ולדון קל וחומר ממנו. I have to look how the Yetzer Hara is operating and to learn a קל וחומר. קל וחומר is a so much more so. If the Yetzer Hara is knocking on my door day and night and is persistent and he doesn't let go, so much more so, then I have to do that when it comes to Avodat Hashem. If he's able to do that. So this is what it means. You should look, take a proof from how the Yetzer Hara is doing. So you know, the Talmud tells us that we can learn a lot from a thief. I once gave a class. I don't think it was recorded. I think one day I will give this class again. Because the Talmud gives beautiful wisdom what we should learn from a thief. Seven things that one should learn from a thief. He's very persistent. He doesn't give up. He comes at night. If it doesn't work the first time, he comes the next time. So the Talmud says, listen, even from something as low and degraded as a thief, you can learn a lot of good things. So much more so what you can learn from the Yetzer Hara. You know, when the army or an intelligence agency, they want to do a certain mission, what do you think? They send a rookie? They send the best agent they have. If the Mossad right now wants to get rid of somebody, you think they're sending some young guy that is only 2 years in the service? They'll take the guy who's already 30 years in the service, he's like a spirit, like a ghost, nobody sees him, he goes in and out, does the job, gets wherever needs to out of commission. Why do you think the Samech Mem is selling the Yetzer Hara? You think the Yetzer Hara is a rookie? He's a professional. He's a professional killer And he's one of the top generals in the army of the Sitra Acha. So I need to look at his methods and to mimic him. You know, I Baruch Hashem, Hashem gave me a lot of talents, and I'm not saying it to sound like a arrogant person. I'm saying it because the talents, the main talent that I feel that the Kadosh Baruch Hu gave me, because Baruch Hashem, and again, not to sound like a pot, but I'm a man of many trades. I have many, many trades. Unbelievable. And even like physical, like in business, I have so many different trades. Baruch Hashem. And that's the funny thing, that I used these trades in the past to make a lot of money. Now I use all these trades to spread Torah. I'll give you an example. I'm a professional video editor, a professional photographer, a professional cinematographer. These are all things that I learned in school for. Professional designer. All these things I use to spread the Torah now, and many other things. But really the talent that I feel that the Kadosh Baruch Hu gave me is not to actually do the thing. I have a very good talent to look how somebody else does something, and I know how to mimic it. So I would look, if let's say, I just need to look one time what the person does. Not too long ago we had a professional person, Ken, like a plumber, to fix something. I just looked over his shoulder what he does. Next time, I don't need you anymore. I saw how to do it. I saw where you get the material. I saw how you fixed it. End of story. I know how to do it. So, and that's with many other things. You know, I learned in school cinematography, which usually takes a long time, especially the editing part. I sat over the shoulder of an editor for a couple months. I just looked. I told him, you don't have to talk. I'm just going to look. What you do, what you press, how you cut, what's the buttons you use. A few months later, I was a professional editor. So why am I telling you that? Not to show off or something, to emphasize, you need to know how to mimic things. If you know how to look at somebody over the shoulder, and to carbon copy it, to copy paste, then take that, take this ability that Hashem gave you, and then do that to the Yetzer Harah, to your enemy. If you know how to copy your enemy, you know how to use his methods. Now if the Yetzer, look what the Yetzer Harah is doing to you. He's persistent, he doesn't let go. He's tricky in a not nice way. Take all this, and do us so much more so. In Torah learning, we call it a kal v'chomer. That if he can do it, so much more so that I can do it. So he says here, look at the Yetzer Hara, take the testimony, be testifying, how do you say, the witness. The witness is looking, and then he goes and testifies. So this is what it means, likach re'aya. Take a testimony of the Yetzer Hara, veladun kal v'chomer mimeno, and learn a kal v'chomer from it, and so much more so, meaning that what he can do, I can do better. There's a song like that, no? Anything you can do, I can do better. Very good. Yeah, right? Who is this? Frank Sinatra? Anyways, but at least I got the song. Nevertheless, ki anu roim sheyetzer hara masit umfateh et ha'adam acher ta'avot ha'olam. What is really the Yetzer Hara trying to do to you? He's trying to get you off the path. This is called lehasit. It's to change your your chain of thought. Lehasit means there is a word for it.
Focus?
No. Let's say you like a certain person, and I come and I very systematically poison you to don't like this person. This is called lehasit, that because it comes from the word in Hebrew stia. Stia is when you take off. So people do it to other people. There will be a person, they don't like them for whatever reason. They go and they badmouth everybody. They go to everybody and says, you know that person? He's a thief. He's a liar. He did this, he did that. And they're slowly getting everybody against that person. This is called lehasit. So, and it comes from the word in Hebrew, stia. Stia is when you take off, you go off the path you're going on. What does the Yetzer Hara really want? He just wants to lehasit, to take you off your path by tempting you with the desires of this world. Here's a beautiful cake, here's a beautiful wine, whatever it is, a beautiful car, money, women. He's trying to give you off your focus. This is his agenda, by the way, because the agenda of the Samech Mem is a whole different agenda. The agenda of the Samech Mem is just to cause conflicts between people. He doesn't care if you sin or not, because he knows you'll do tshuva. He knows you can do tshuva. The Samech Mem, the Satan himself, he cares about arguments. He's only going to come and make arguments between two people. That's his agenda. So you have to know your enemy, where the enemy is attacking from. The Yetzer Harah, his agenda is to seduce you with the desires of this world, to get you off your focus. I don't know if you ever shot in a shooting range. And in the army, we used to shoot daily in shooting range. You have to become a real good shooter. At some point in the army, I went, in the way it works in the army, every platoon each soldier has a different role. So there's a medic, there's the communication guy, there's the heavy artillery, whatever it is. Then there's always two or three snipers. So I was a sniper. You have to go to a special course, and then you come back to the unit, and you are a sniper. And the snipers, needless to say, their job is to be the sniper. So in the course, all day long you're shooting with different rifles, different guns. So we would always have jokes that when somebody would sit and shoot, somebody would come like with a long stick or something and put something in his ear. So you lose your focus, suddenly you shoot somewhere else. And we would all, of course, laugh, and that would be like the joke of the platoon. But why am I saying that? Because when you're aiming, you are so concentrated. You know, even in sniper course, they teach you breathing techniques that you don't, because when you breathe, you're moving so slightly, even a millimeter makes a difference. So they teach you breathing techniques that you don't move your body. Anyways, long story short, you are so focused on the target, and sometimes as a sniper, you need to be focused on the target for an hour, and you know how to move. If you need to take something out, you have to be on the target for a very long time. A moment that you don't look, you can miss. This is what the Yetzirah does. You are focused. I need to learn. I need to do mitzvot. I need to work on myself. And the Yetzirah is coming and doing all these distractions. He gets you off your focus. That's what he wants. He's like this annoying clown that wants to get you off your focus. Okay. Ta'avot behemiyot shehem kelim venifsadim. What is exactly these forbidden relations that the Yetzer Hara is trying to distract you with? Animalistic desires, which is eating, it's sleeping, marital relations, physical pleasures. That's an animal that only looks for pleasure. I never saw an animal grabbing a book and sitting and reading a book. An animal just wants to eat, and then it wants to procreate and sleep and move and sleep and up and eat, and that's what the Yetzer Hara. Now all these desires that are animalistic, these are called kelim nifsadim. These are vessels that are going to cause you to lose something at the end. If you know how to recognize what's going to give you profit, then you'll go. I mean, I don't know people who go and buy stocks that will go down. You want to buy stocks that go up. So, and the same thing with a car. You don't go to a car lot and say to the guy, give me the worst car you have here. You have a car that the engine is about to break. So same thing here. Why would you want to buy a tool that is broken? And this is what the Yetzer Hara is giving you. He's giving you tools that they're already bound to lose. They're not going to give you, they're not going to gain you anything. Not only that, en be mamash. They have no mamashut, nothing substantial to them. Ve'kal v'chomer elef alafim, ech ra'ui lichsof v'lishtokek la'avodat Hashem. And what you need to learn from that is a kal v'chomer, so much more so, how much you need to desire thousands and thousands times more the desire to serve Hashem and to make Hashem happy. La'avodat Hashem itbach, l'sameach oto itbach, shu chai chayachayim borei hakol. I should need to take this excitement and desire for things that are prohibited and forbidden and are empty. I'm not going to get anything out of it. You like we were talking now in the class before. What is the result when you lust a woman? What's going to be the result? A two-minute pleasure, and then it's over. Why don't you put your money where a stock is going to actually give you something? If you're investing in something that's going to make you lose, sorry to tell you, you are a fool. But if you take your money and you're looking for a good investment, same thing here. Then invest your excitement in Avodat Hashem. When you're taking proof, the method of system, how the Yetzer Hara works, and you acquire that and you take that for you to serve Hashem, נמצא שעושה מין בחינת החסרונות, בחינת שלמות. You are taking something that has lacking, that is missing, the Yetzer Harah, the unholiness, and you're transforming it to something that has shlemut, holiness, complete. And that's why it says, Yitamu chataim. Yitamu means they will finish. But Yitamu comes from the root of the word in Hebrew, tam. Tam is complete, is whole. Yaakov ish yoshev oalim. He was tam, whole. There was no room for anything, no room for any junk to come in. That's why he says, Yitamu chataim. Take the sin and fill it up. Take the cup and fill it up to the top so nothing else can come in there. Yitamu lashon temimut veshlimut. Yitamu can be derived from the root of temimut, which means whole, and shlemut is completion, complete. Haynu lasot temimut veshlimut min hachesronot min hachataim. Take the deficiencies that you have in your life and fill them up, make them whole. You know, you can take one of the most greatest, holiest mitzvot in the world, which is to bring a child to the world, and if you use it from the side of impurity, it's one of the biggest sins in the world. You take it to the side of purity, it's one of the greatest mitzvot you can do. So you take the sin and you fill it up all the way to the top. Zehu itamu lashon tmimut. That's why it says itamu, that it should be full and whole. Zehu shemesayim min haaretz. That's why it ends from the verse with the words min haaretz, from the land. What does it mean? Haynu shemin haaretziyut, from the physicality of the Yetzer Hara, mavi atzmo rayal avodat Hashem. You look at the Yetzer Hara and you take that as proof for your avodat Hashem. Vazai nimtza sheoseh min hachesronot shlemuyot v'tmimot. You take something that is lacking and you're making it perfect. How much better is to take something broken and fix it, and to take the darkness and to transform it into light. Vazeo sheomrim oto b'rosh chodesh. That's why we say it on Rosh Chodesh. Ki Rosh Chodesh hu moreh al tikun pgam halevana. Rosh Chodesh is the time, like I said before, for rectification. If you remember, in the beginning, the sun and the moon were the same size. And the sun was supposed to rule during the day, and the moon was supposed to be the ruling through the night. And the moon says, hey, how can what? Two kings are going to share a crown? So Hashem says, okay, you're right. And made the moon much, much smaller. He says, now there's only one king. So you open your mouth from jealousy, then you end up getting the short end of the stick. But nevertheless, now the light of the moon is diminished. There's a pgam there. There's a deficiency and a lack in the moon, a blemish. Rosh Chodesh is the time for fixing the blemish of the moon. That's why we count the moon, the month, or the lunar cycle, not the sun cycle. The year it goes by the sun cycle. But the month is go by the moon cycle. So the time of Rosh Chodesh is the time to the rectification of the blemish of the moon. Where does the Yetzer Hara come from? From the blemish of the moon, because the moon said it didn't say really lashon hara, but it had a complaint. When the moon was diminished, that's where the Yetzer Hara is rooted from. והיצר הרע הוא פגם הלבנה, והקדושה הוא בבחינת מלאות הלבנה. And the קדושה is coming to represent when the moon is full. The יצר הרע is, so to say, when the moon is, in the beginning the moon is empty. You only see a little bit of the moon. Then slowly, slowly it fills up. So the קדושה, the holiness, is when the moon is full. The יצר הרע is when the moon is empty. וכשמשלים הקדושה על ידי היצר, וכשמשלים הקדושה על ידי היצר הרע, when I'm making קדושה, holiness, full, by the יצר הרע, נמצא שממלא את פגם הלבנה. When I'm taking the methods of the יצר הרע and applying it for holiness, then what I do is I'm filling in, so to say, the moon. I just told you now that the יצר הרע and the סטרח is like a half-full cup. You just need to fill it up. The Yetzer Hara is like a moon in the beginning when it's a little bit empty. You just need to fill it up. And therefore, ועל כן אומרים זה השיר בראש חודש כנזכר לעיל. And that's why we say specifically this verse, this chapter of Tehillim in Rosh Chodesh, because Rosh Chodesh is the time that when I can fill up the Tumah, is to take what is missing and add. You see, in Rosh Chodesh, the moon is empty. You don't see the moon. You know, when you see the moon in the middle of the month, now look at night, you're not going to see a moon. Now is when the Yetzer Harah is most depleted. It's the most empty. It's the time now to add the Kedushah into everything that I do. And that's how I rectify the damage of the moon. And that's why after that, the moon starts being full and full and full and becomes full. And this is representing, so to say, that the Kedushah is in its fullest. So saying in other words, I need to look at the methods of the Yetzer Harah and to mimic him. And you know, when you want to do something good, you open a restaurant and you want to, and you have a competitor, you want to know what they're using in their gravy, what they're putting in that sauce that everybody's crazy about it. And you want to know the method. The Yetzer Harah has some secret methods here, because he's doing so well, he can flip you up and down within 3 seconds with no mercy. I want to know how he's doing that. I want to know where he's coming with all these methods, and he's able to win me. That way I can win him. So all I need to do is get my CIA, my Mossad, to go behind enemy lines, find out what he's doing, and do the same thing to him. So this is exactly what the verse is coming to tell, because on Rosh Chodesh, like I mentioned before, is the time of atonement, the time of kapara, when we can reach kapara, kavonot, atonement. So it's a time when we're not only that we get forgiven to the sins. To get forgiven to the sins, that's one thing. I need an atonement for the sin. It's two different things. And the analogy I gave before is that imagine that you have a debt in the bank account and you have a very large debt, a $100,000 debt. Now, for whatever reason, the bank manager went crazy and he calls and tells you, I'm forgiving you for the debt. You don't owe us anything anymore. Really? Yeah. You want to go to that bank, of course. So, but what's this analogy? If I'm if my sins are forgiven, that's very nice, but I still owe the debt. I need the bank manager to come and tell me, we're eliminating the debt. Not only the here, the bank manager can call and tell you, listen, I forgive you, but still pay me the debt. So what's your forgiveness worth to me if I still have to pay the debt? So I walk sometimes into the bank and the bank manager smiles to me, and if I tell him I need more credit, I need to pay the debt, he's a lot of smiling. I think in banking school they teach you how to smile. So, but nevertheless, I need not only for the debt to be forgiven, I need to be atoned. I need to get now from the bank the certificate that's saying you don't have to pay the 100,000 anymore. So getting my sins forgiven, that's good. I need my sins to be atoned, that the blemish of the sin is being removed. And this is what happens on Rosh Chodesh. Zman kapara lekol toldotam. I told you before we pray to pay attention to the words that we're reading. It's the time for the atonement. So we should reach to the level that we do real tshuva, so I can get atonement that I don't have the debt anymore. The forgiveness I want, but I want more the atonement. And the time of that is the time of Yom Rosh Chodesh, a very auspicious time to overpower the Yetzer Harah. The Yetzer Harah is the most diminished at this Rosh Chodesh. Like the first day of the month, the moon is, you can barely see it. That's how weak the Yetzer Harah is on Rosh Chodesh. And he grows. You want to make sure that when he grows, you grow with him, so you know how to battle him the right way. And you want to get to a point that at some point he gets, if you have a cup, don't have a cup to show, but imagine a cup, the Yetzer Harah can never reach to the top. He can only reach to a little bit before the top. There's always going to be room for something. That's for you to fill in Kedusha, and you completely overpower the Yetzer Harah. So this is the difference between holiness and unholiness. Holiness is whole, unholiness is missing. And you just need to know how to use the Yetzer Harah. The Yetzer Harah filled up the cup all the way, almost till the end. All you need to do is pour a little bit in. That's it. You already gain the completion. Once you gain the completion and you fill the cup till the top, and that's just the analogy. Don't just start filling up cups. Just giving the analogy of filling up the cup. Let the Yetzer Harah do his job and fill it up all the most till the end. And he can't do anymore. You just add a little bit of Kedusha and holiness and you complete it. Once you fill up the vessel, the Yetzer Harah has no power. He's completely powerless. And needless to say, that we have to mimic his methods. You know, your Yetzer Harah is different than my Yetzer Harah. We all have a different Yetzer Harah. He knows that you like chocolate and you like ice cream and you like coffee and you like blondes and you like brunettes. I'm sorry that that's what I'm saying, but everybody has their what they like. The Yetzer Harah knows exactly what to show you. Because for one person, you know, this will tempt him, another person that will tempt him. You need to know your Yetzer Harah. I cannot give you advice about your Yetzer Harah. And you learn his methods very thoroughly, and you do us so much more, so a kal vachomer. If he can do that to me, so much more, so I can do it to him. That's how you start winning the Yetzer Harah, when you have your upper hand. Rosh Chodesh is the time, because the Yetzer Harah is in the most weakest point of the month. That's the time when you can easily overpower him. That's what Shimon and Levi did. If you remember, when they went to destroy Shechem, they were smart. They were like, okay, guys, you got to circumcise yourself in order to marry our sister and our daughters. They went and circumcised themselves. They waited for the third day when they're all weak and in pain. That's when they went in. Oh, now you're weak. Now I'm going to take you out. So now today, the Yetzer Harah is weak. Now take him out. And even more weaker tomorrow when it's Aleph of Rosh Chodesh, it's Mamash, the beginning. He's the weakest of the most weak that he gets. Now you overpower him and you take him while he's down. Zad Hashem should merit to have a very successful and prosperous Rosh Chodesh, a month, or exactly like how we read in the Tefillah, Slichat Chet v'mchilat Avon, for forgiving us for our sins and removing the torment, a month of livelihood, Parnasa and Kalkala, and finance and love and Yirat Shamayim and all these good things that we need. Hashem should bless us with unbelievable abundance, that we should grow and grow spiritually, physically, mentally, emotionally, and Bezrat Hashem should have a very successful month.